family. But what I need to say is really is that welcome everyone. Danny's celebration of life because we're really all family here. Everybody knows one another pretty well. Danny Ray Laszlo, 66 of Tulare, California, was called home on Monday, May 17, 2021. He was born on June 5th, 1954 in Hanford, California. Danny is preceded in death by his parents, Russell and Lucille Laszlo of Tulare, sister Doris Richmond of Tulare, and brothers David Laszlo of Tulare, Ray Laszlo of Dinuba, and Jack Laszlo of Kingsburg. He is survived by his wife of 35 years, LaDonna Laszlo of Tulare, sons Matthew Kimber Laszlo of Oregon, David and Samantha Laszlo of Tulare, Brian Kayla Henson of Fresno, and daughter Rebecca Matthew Wareham of Bakersfield. Siblings Dorothy Roberts of Tulare, Larry Donetta Laszlo of Tulare, Sharon Laszlo of Tulare, and Barbara Glenn Petrie of Clovis. Danny had 11 grandchildren and numerous nieces and nephews and countless friends. Danny attended school in Madera and Tulare and was employed primarily as a truck driver for most of his life. Danny most loved spending time with his family and friends. He has also enjoyed listening to the music of his late brother David Laszlo. I have to say, so did I. Danny loved to play guitar, country music, build things, loved old coins, reading books, working in his vegetable garden, antiques and various collectibles, and was quite the history buff. Danny loved laughter and making people around him happy. He had a very quick wit with a charming sense of humor. You couldn't be around him without laughing and thoroughly enjoying yourself. He will be greatly missed by all who knew him. Music, but I think we all like music. I liked it quite a bit back in the, when I was younger. I played a lot of the country music too. That's how I met David. I didn't realize it. Years later, I found out that he played with my cousin, Danny Rader, and all of them out there in Patterson Track. Right now, I would like to read a scripture that's fitting. And let me stress one more thing to you folks this morning. This is not a funeral. It's not. It's a celebration of life. I found out that Danny was looking up to the sky to the Lord and said, "Oh God, please help me." And he told some others, "Please help me." And that's all it takes. That's all it takes. In the book of Romans, the 14th chapter, the 7th and 8th verse says this right here. Listen to these words, please. "For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or we die, we belong to the Lord." This is a, like I said, this is a celebration of life. What we're going to do right now is that I want to open this service up for comments. Son, you said you wanted to be the first one to come up here and put some comments. Come on up. That's fine.
So, my dad was a good man. He was a good father. He was generous. He loved with his whole heart. He didn't have, he'd always show everybody, I know everybody here knows what I'm talking about, all these cool little trinkets he'd find at random places. And all you have to say is, "Man, that's cool." And maybe you were just being polite, but he'd say, "Oh, you like it here." He'd give anything he had. He'd give his shirt off his back. He'd love his grandchildren. I've never for a second doubted that he loved me. My brother, he wished he could be here, my brother Matthew, but he unfortunately couldn't make it. And he thanks everyone for coming, as well as I. He was a good man. He taught me how to be a good man. And I, I'm, I just hope I'm doing my best to honor him. Thank you all for coming.
Now, if there's others that have comments, you can come up here to the podium, or you can stand or sit right where you're at and speak your mind. Don't hesitate. If you have something and you remember about some laughter about something or whatever situation, please have your freedom to do that right now.
Somebody wants to speak, but you know, I can't do it.
Yeah. It's a difficult time, but you find out
that's there. I mean, I have nothing but good to say about Danny. Yeah. I've known for a little while for Steve, and nothing but all good stuff. Very nice guy.
I met him when I was a little kid through my Uncle Lee, and turned out to be a really good friend of mine. Growing up through the years, and then once I found out he was a history buff on war, war history, I just went out of my way and got him everything war movie I could think of. Every time I come across it, I was always getting them for him and bringing them to him. And then I gave him some coins for collectible stuff, you know, that was because his son was in the military, so he really was proud of him for joining the military. So everything to do with military, I find it, I bring it to him and give it to him for years. And I don't know, he's just a great guy, man. I have a lot of bass with him, and now he's going to be up there with my Uncle Lee and David and just partying it up there.
Come on up. You want something else? You want to say something, Sharon?
You want me to do it now?
Sure, if you'd like to, go right ahead. Don't look at formal or informal. This is a celebration of life. We just take it and roll, okay? That's what it's all about.
Because I stutter. And I might. Thanks, everyone, for coming today. I guess you guys all know he was my big brother. He was, since David died, he was pretty much the head of the family as far as the guys go. The oldest man to go, so big shoes to fill for my brother Larry now. Danny was first and foremost a family man. He loved his family. He loved LaDonna, he loved Matthew and David and Brian, and he was so proud to be able to say he had one daughter in all those boys, Becky. His nieces and nephews and his grandkids were just the light of his life. Little Teddy kept him on his toes, though. He keeps everyone on his toes.
All he did was give him cookies.
You know, all of my brothers are so loving and sweet and kind, and I think they're all that way because of me. I mean, to me, not necessarily to everybody, but they are. I've always been great big brothers, and Danny was probably not any more than the other brothers, but he was the most generous soul. Like David said, anything that you seen that he had and you thought it was nice or cool or pretty or everything, you couldn't go to his house and say, oh, that's pretty, because you left with it. He wouldn't let you leave without, he wanted you to have what he wanted, even if he worked so hard to get it. If you wanted it, for sure. Danny would give you, this, like David said, the shirt off his back. He's always been that way. We had, I don't know, that was just instilled to us at a young age, I guess, and he carried it forth and he gave it to his kids. Everyone was proud of him. I know that Larry and Danny grew up with, David was a little bit older, already out chasing the girls, I'm sure. But Larry and Danny spent a lot of time in the dirt before I came along, playing with army men and trucks, and they grew up together. Larry loved collecting the silver coins, and Danny would call him at night and ask him what he had so he could look it all up, and I'll call you right back, bro. Look it up, and he'd call Larry back, and he was so excited to tell Larry, that thing is worth a dollar, it's worth $1.15, or whatever it was. He was just so excited. Or if it was worth more, he just got so tickled about it. He'd give you anything that you ever wanted. He had an interest in everything. He loved coins and collecting knives and trinkets and antiques and books and movies and music and guitars. He loved to listen to David. He loved telling his stories, and I'm going to miss all of those so much. So much. I know that when we were sitting with Danny Monday when he slipped away, I know that he took his last breath with us, and he took his next breath in the presence of the Lord, because it says in Corinthians, I believe it is, that, or 2 Corinthians, Brother Ronnie might have to correct me, that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Yes.
So that's what gives me comfort, and everyone, I hope, will seek that comfort in knowing that we'll see him again one day. And when he cried out to God and for help, I believe that those prayers were answered for Danny. He was amazing. I just can't say enough about him. I know you guys all know everything about him that I'm probably telling you. But there wasn't anything that he wouldn't do for anybody. He loved his family more than anything. And I'm going to miss my long text messages. It would take him 45 minutes to type a long message out in a text. I couldn't understand what he said anyway. Because a lot of times he would talk into it, or he didn't know how to delete the character, so he would just start over. And I'm going to miss all that.
He didn't learn about emojis.
Yeah, he didn't even know how to spell emoji. when he was in the hospital last week, he loved to be spoiled. Every time he would call me to come over, he would tell me he found something new he wanted to show me. Please stop by, sis, just for a minute, just for a minute. There's no such thing as a minute with Danny, if you guys know that. There's no such thing, a quick stop in. And he'd say, well, if you're going to come over, I won't be mad if you bring me a milkshake. I won't be mad. Or a frappuccino. I told LaDonna yesterday that when we came in and looked at him, he looked like he was laying there just asleep, ready to open his eyes and start talking to me and yelling at her. But he did it in a loving way, didn't he? He did. Danny was the best big brother, and we told him that before he passed. I think he could hear us all. And Larry, I know he was your best friend, and he was yours. He loved you to pieces, and he was the best big brother to all of us. And he's going to be missed, and he's already missed. But there's hope for one day that we all are together again. And my sister Dot is in there sitting, and she wanted me to tell Danny, now lay there and wiggle. Thank you guys all for coming.
They said there's a story about Paul, when she was talking about being absent this body and present with the Lord, that they were getting ready to cut off his head. They were going to kill him. They say that Paul, when the guards were getting ready to take him out there, he just broke loose from one of them, put his head on the block, and they looked at him and says, Paul, are you out of your mind? Don't you know that we're fixing to take your life? He said, hey, you're doing me a favor. To be absent in this life is to be in the presence of my God. And that's the reason he ran, that he always talked about running the good race. Someone else. We have plenty of time here, folks. Anyone else? Well, let's break this up a little bit about doing a song. How's that? Wanted to, whatever. She just said, hey, when there's time, if you would like to sing a song. I said, well, Ben's the invitation is there, I'll take advantage of it. It's a song that we all know, most of us. You've been around. It's Amazing Grace. It's about a story about a captain of a ship that was a slave trader. And he had a bunch of slaves on board. He was taking them back to sell to make some money. And they ran into squalls and a big storm on the ocean. And he said, cut the slaves loose, take them, take the irons off of them. And they lived through it. And immediately, the ship wrecked, by the way, but they all made it to a shore. And when they got there, he looked up and seen all the men that were with him, and he seen the slaves. And he fell upon his knees, and he wrote that song, Amazing Grace. Please help me. This is a congregational song. Let's just all sing it together. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was Savior has rescued me. Yes. That those words, nobody knows me like God does. And it gets to me. Because I know where I was at. I was a perverted, messed up man. And I thought that I'd went too far, that I wasn't worthy of God's forgiveness. But he showed me differently. No matter where we're at.
Amen.
It's impossible for God to stop loving you. As long as you got a breath in your lungs, you are able to ask God's forgiveness. Sure. And your whole life will change. It has for me.
Me too.
Yes. I'll tell you what. I always loved Jesus, but now I'm in love with Jesus. There's a difference there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me do something special here. By the way, I apologize for that song at the end. Nobody can do it like Brother Charlie can. I'm about to read you something that probably 99.9%, if not 100% of you have never heard before. This is what happened to Danny. Danny received an eviction notice of life from God. And I'm about to show you why. From God the Father, streets of gold, peace-filled heaven. Danny Ray Laswell. In my name I do greet you as I sit here in the quiet comfort of my paradise. I thought that I would review the lease that you signed with me 66 years ago in the house that you now live in. On June 5th, 1954 in Hanford, California, you agreed to move into this house and remain there as long deemed it that is necessary for the house to be suitable for life. In checking the terms of your lease, I found it necessary to condemn the house that you are living in because it is not in the same shape that it was in when you moved in. Several repairs have been made on your house, and the more the house is repaired, there are more repairs that need to be done. In other words, there is a leak in your building, and your soul has got to move. I understand that you have enjoyed living there, and perhaps you have gotten comfortable there, but I see some dangers that you don't see if you continue to stay there. If you stay there, I see many more restless nights. I see a body racked with aches and pains, and furthermore, I see some weary days and some lonely nights. Danny, this letter serves as an official notice of eviction, and upon receiving it, you are to vacate the premise immediately. Don't worry about where you are going to live after you are evicted. I have instructed John to write in the 14th chapter of his gospel that in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. In other words, I have another house for you, and there is plenty of room, so rest. It is not that you have not paid the rent. The house is just not fit to live anymore. As your landlord, it is my job to check the property every now and then to see if it is fit to live. The new house that you will be living in is eternal in the heavens. In this house, you don't have to worry about the floor squeaking or the roof leaking or the foundation giving away. It is a mansion, bright and fair. I have instructed my angel to deliver this notice to you at Tulare, California on May 17, 2021. I have also instructed my angel not to return without you, regardless of how much you want to stay there. The angel will not return empty-handed. Danny, don't feel that I am picking on you or taking you from your loved ones. For one day, they will answer, for they will be somewhere listening for their name. Signed, your heavenly landlord. Listen to me. I believe that with all of my heart. Because God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you even until the end of time. Amen. Danny cried out, oh God, help me. He heard that cry. Rest in peace. This is a celebration of life. He's not there no more. He's already in the presence of paradise. Amen. For eternity. Think about that. Yes, what it is that we're greedy. We don't want to let our loved ones go because we want to keep them here. But he says, it's like there's a song out called Gathering Flowers for the Master's Bouquet. Beautiful flowers that will never decay. He was at the perfect time for taking him to bring him there. If he left it in honor, he may have missed it. But he was at a perfect time in life where he wanted to take him, where he would be with him for eternity. Let that give your heart peace. I believe it. If I didn't believe it, I wouldn't be standing up here telling you this. Trust me what I'm saying. I believe with all of my heart that he is in a much better place. And there's nothing else. There won't be no more sickness. He did get healed for eternity. He's in the presence of God. He's full of soul. If you could see him, if he liked to dance, you'd probably see him. I'm doing the Hallelujah Shuffle up and down Hallelujah Boulevard. I'm telling you, that's the kind of excitement that God puts in you. And I believe that it's there. I believe that it's there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Do you have anything else that you'd like to talk about, Sharon, or anything, your family or anything? Well, I've got a prayer here that I want to pray. It's special to me. I can find it here. If you would please bow your heads with me. This is the best that I can do for you right now. You, O God, are our great physician. Nothing is too difficult for you. Bring your healing power to the brokenhearted this day, and grant us peace as we remember that you hold each of us tenderly in the palm of your hand. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, I say amen, amen, and amen. Let me explain to you. Some of you may not know what amen means. It's like a judge bringing down a gavel. So be it. That's what happened when he yelled, "Oh God, help me." The judge said, the gavel in God's hand said, "He's innocent. Because your righteousness is like filthy rags to me. But when I see the blood of my son upon your heart, it changes everything. He is innocent for eternity." I hope that gives you some comfort. I've done the best that I know how to do here today. But he can always do things for you every day. My mother used to say that Jesus is just a whisper away. It's just a mere thought. Just a mere thought of it. It's so fast that there's no such thing as time to be able to tell you how fast it happens, because it's instantaneously. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. There are, every one of you, please, one thing before I close. Blink your eyes. God said it will happen in the blink of an eye. There's over 360,000 twinkles in the blink of an eye. In the twinkling of an eye, it'll happen just like that. That's what happened today. God bless each and every one of you. I tell you that you got a great family here. I wish I would have known all of you better than what I do. I met probably every one of you at one time in my life or another. Back in those days, I didn't take much time or heed of anything. I was running as fast as I go, burning the candle at both ends. Does that bring any memories to anybody? Oh, yeah, that's what I was doing. Now I take time. And I smell the roses. I take my walk seriously. The life that God has given me, I take it very seriously. And I'm trying to take as many people as I can with me to heaven.
Right.
If you want to see Daddy, there's only one way, through Jesus Christ.
Right.
God bless you. Is anybody here got anything they'd like to say?
God bless you.
You know what? I'll take that. I never turned down a blessing. There are the people said there's small blessings and there are big blessings. No, there's not. There's blessings. No one's any greater. Not one blessing is any greater than the other, because the small blessings what you might need the most. All I know is I won't go on any longer. I just love to be around people that I see are receptive to God's word. And God bless you. And unless you have something else, this part of the service can be
concluded.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. We could probably get them maybe to turn back on the video again, and everybody can visit and talk and everything. I'll go have her turn that on for you right now.
Thank you.
Did you turn yours off?
Oh, my ankle, did you hear it pop? Do you know how to stop ours?